but you can welcome.
Hello, everybody. I'm going to turn the video around. It's so on the count of three, everyone, make some noise. We're live on Facebook Live, September 2017. Learning Roundtable. Here we go.
Okay. So there we go. If you want to hold that. Okay. So you'll want it, Claire. You'll want to hold it looking this way so that your hand's not in the way, so you can see what you're videoing. Okay. Okay. So I want everyone to put their, or invite you to put your right hand in the air.
Yay, you did it.
Because oh my, what a bone she was this morning. And big thank yous to Kathy A for being patient with, this is like the most bizarre morning of getting people on the compound. It's never been this complicated. And also for her being willing to do Facebook Live. Because we have people like gathering from, I think, Switzerland and France. And people are like, am I missing it? Have you started yet? It's like, no, we haven't started. So. And if you don't know about Facebook Live, it will be recorded and it will live on the, in our group, so you can go back when if you want to review some cool stuff with Kathy's, it will live there. So, and just sort of tug on my shoulder throughout the. At some point, if you don't want to be videoed, if you don't want to be in the Facebook Live, so we're playing with this. It's our first time. At the very end of today, would love to hear your thoughts of what worked, what didn't work with the Facebook Live. It's brand new. So I'm not going to take very much time. I just wanted to welcome you. My name is Leanne Reagan. I'm the founder and facilitator of the Learning and Development Roundtable. We've been meeting almost 5 years now, if you can believe it, almost 5 years this fall. So what we can do is do a quick roundabout. If you want to introduce yourself very briefly, just your name. The organization that you represent, and if you're not with an organization, just something about yourself. So,
Hi, I'm Susanna Reiner. I've been in Kenya for 2 years now. I have two kids, and yes, I'm part of Here We Are. We try and organize monthly meetings for expat spouses who can't get a work permit. And I'm happy to be here and also get inspired today.
Hi, my name is Shruti. I'm Kenyan. I've got two children, so I've lived here all my life. It's my first roundtable today, so really looking forward to it. I'm part of the Here We Are as well, and I'm a life coach.
And there's extra seats like around here. Please feel free to join us if you're comfortable.
Thank you.
I'm Susanna. I'm Hungarian origin, but moved here from Norway. I've been working for a German chemical company for 10 years, but now I'm home with my baby, who's 1.5. And so I'm a spouse here without work permit. And this is my second time here, and I really enjoyed the last one. So I'm looking forward to that one.
I'm Hannah. And I am also part of the Here We Are, founding that here, and then I'm currently setting up Wonder Walks, which I'll tell you more about when it's all coming out, but it's to do with coaching and walking and moving and reflecting and learning. So, yeah.
I don't know which way.
Hello, I'm Claire. Been in Kenya for a short time. I'm a retired university lecturer, and that's what I'm doing here.
Great,
thanks.
Now do I give it to you?
Yeah.
Okay. Hi, I'm Anita. I'm part of Here We Are, and I also work with a Global Trauma Project.
Hello, I'm Donovan. In Kenya, 3 years, going into the fourth year. I am a spouse. My wife works for ICRAF, and so I'm part of the round table, and here we are.
Hi, I'm Jessica. I'm a hypnotherapist by trade. I've been coming to the round table now for just over a year. I've been in Kenya for a year. I'm also part of the Here We Are network, and I'm really looking forward to seeing what we'll see today.
Good morning, I'm Sharon. I am working at Vossland Academy as one of the guidance counselors there. I I've been here since 1994. At Roslyn.
Oh, wow.
And
she drives a scooter.
That's and I drive awesome. A scooter. And I'm old, so it's pretty cool.
Hi, I'm Jody. I've been in Kenya for 9 years now. I am a cultural anthropologist, so I do intercultural training and advice, and also a part-time teacher.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Great. My name is Gladys. I'm Kenyan. I'm a researcher and an innovation specialist. This is my first time to be here. And I'm looking forward to really learn from this session. This is a very interesting topic for me. So I'm looking forward to network as well as learn from you. Thank you.
Hello everyone. Good morning. I'm Pankaj. I'm the training manager at the British Council here. I've been here in Kenya for 4 years, and I must tell you, I've fallen in love with Kenya. You said 3 years. I don't want to leave now. Thank you.
I'm sorry, I'm trying to click off the name so you can make connections, but I missed the last two. So you're Gladys class. And sorry, sir?
Pankaj, British Council, I...
Yeah.
All right.
Welcome.
Thank you.
Good morning, I'm Julie. I moved to Kenya just over a year ago, and I'm a psychotherapist.
Morning, my name is Faye. I work with Action Against Hunger. I've been in Kenya for over 10 years with work permit. I've been coming to the L&D roundtable for the past couple of years, on and off, depending on the agenda and also availability.
Hi, my name is Charles. I work with Action Against Hunger as well. And I've been in Kenya all my life, since I'm Kenyan. And yeah, we're excited to see what the session this time around is all about.
Morning, everybody. My name is Wachogo, and I'm a business person. I sell textiles, and I also make clothes. So yeah, I'm very interested in knowing what's up today.
Hi everyone, my name is Paris. I'm a facilitator at Strongstart.
Hi, I'm Monica. It's my first time here. I'm really expectant. I work for Strongstart.
Hi, I'm Janet Kirubi. I volunteer as Independent Disabled Person of Kenya. Yeah, and it's my first time here.
Hi everyone.
Hi.
My name is Miriam. I'm an independent facilitator. I've formerly worked with healthcare workers, but I'm now setting up a program for teenagers.
Mm-hmm. We'll get to Kathy for a bit. And Jen.
Hi, my name is Jen Cotter. I'm the CEO of Spire Education. Apologies for being a bit late. I had some confusion at the front desk. What Spire does is we focus on helping people build the mindsets and skills to be successful in their work.
Okay, well, welcome everyone, and hopefully that gives you some impetus to encourage someone that you're intrigued about, their role, their organization, who they are. Feel free to follow up with them, of course, and even for folks on Facebook Live, feel free to ask questions in the comment section, etc. Okay, just a couple of super quick housekeeping things. If you're able to donate 300 shillings to cover the cost of the badges, that would be great. And 1,000 shillings would be even better, but don't let that affect your ability to attend the roundtable session. We want to keep it as open and as inclusive as possible. If you're asking, well, if I take 1,000 shillings minus 300, what are you doing with the 700? Once a year, we take all of our pool of money and I throw it out to the group of where you want to donate that money, and we decide which organization to donate to, some education-focused organization. So, and if you're able to donate more than 1,000, feel free, the gates are open. I'll pass this around, this envelope. My phone number is on it. Feel free to M-Pesa or put some cash inside. It's up to you. And thanks to those of you who donated before today via M-Pesa. I've got those up, which is wonderful. And know that we're charged that fee whether you come or not. So once you RSVP, we are charged 300 shillings. So I'll come after you if you RSVP, obviously none of the people in this room because you're here, but I do ask for that donation because we do have to pay. We alternate sessions having a guest speaker with a networking session, even though I don't like that term, networking. Basically, every second session we pick a topic. I do a very brief introduction of the topic, and then people spend time in small groups talking about that. So our next session, which is October the 27th, is a networking session, and we don't have a topic for it. So a couple things that people have brought up, which I'll just ask you to percolate on, and then I'll come back to it at the end of today so we can make a decision, is Frizan, who does amazing community engagement work up in Turkana, he talked about wanting to talk about the challenges faced by nomadic pastoralist kids. And so basically, one option is we can talk about how do you reach people who face significant barriers. If you're trying to do education, you're trying to do learning and development training, perhaps that could be a theme. If you're really, whether it's literacy issues or issues of distance or issues of, poverty, whatever it is, that could be a theme. Also, thanks to Anita, who put up a post in the roundtable Facebook group. There's a MOOC, the most popular MOOC on Coursera, I think it is a learning and development course, which how cool is that? And it's called Learning How to Learn. So one option is we could actually take part of that MOOC, like I could sign up for it, and then we could play it, watch one of the videos or whatever, and then break up into small groups. So that's an idea, and totally open to other options as well. So think about that, what you want to have for your for the networking session next month. Logistics, please read the emails. I try to put all stuff in there. Please don't call me at 10 to 8 in the morning. Not that anyone did that this morning, if you have questions after you read the email, that would be great. And we have, when I send out emails, you'll notice that I BCC them, so I don't share your contact information, but we do have a members online portal. So if you want to be on that list, just email Dipali and she'll get you on that list. Any other kind of quick questions around housekeeping? Okay, so I really want to throw it over quickly to Kathy. And our practice for guest speakers is I ask them for 6 words, and then you as a group pick 2 or 3 of those words, and then she'll introduce herself according to those words. So her 6 words, each of which, of course, have a story behind them, are blue, you can see them up on the thing here, scat, street, water, doodle, and donkeys. So what is one of those words that really, just yell it out, what doodle, okay, so
scat.
Doodle, scat, and one more?
Donkey,
okay, doodle, scat, and donkey. Let's give a big round of applause to Kathy.
Thanks everyone, it's a real pleasure to be here. And this is also new for me. So we will be learning in process. I heard somewhere that September is the new January. For some of us, right? Life moves so fast that every 6 months, something's different. And if we're in this space, like we're on hold to someone for the next 3 months, right? So we're learning to adapt, agility, and resilience. Leanne, how do I bring up the other?
Just while she's doing that, we also have a learning and development resource library. We have a couple of items that have come back, and this might be really exciting for some of you. Those of you who know Danielle Laporte, this is a brand new book. Mm-hmm. And I bought one to support her because she's a dear friend of mine. And I sent her a picture of it. She's like, oh my god, did like a rhino get a hold of it? This is how it arrived. So when I saw her this summer, she gave me another one, which she kindly signed. And I have dedication in the book, which is like, oh, that's so great. For those of you who are meeting me for the first time, I also have a very professional side as well. Anyways, if you want to borrow the book, please see me. The general idea is you keep it for a month and bring it back to the next meeting. If you have things you want to donate, feel free. We also have another one on facilitation here, and also Danielle's two cards, which are really cool cards. So if you want to borrow any of that, just see me at the end of the workshop. You're totally welcome. And please, if you do have stuff you want to donate, feel free to do that as well.
Okay, great. So you pick three words. The first one is donkey. This is going to relate to the presentation this morning, which is a taster session on the concept of intercultural fluency, all about your cultural identity. I am a mediator by training. And if you've ever seen this particular slide anywhere, this is coming from the American Friends Service Committee, which talks about how you resolve conflict, which what they've been doing for over 30 years. I first encountered them when I was in college a quarter of a century ago. So if you look at the picture, right, you have two donkeys tied together, two bales of hay. The natural instinct is to pull, right? But if you pull, you stretch. You pull even harder, now you're even killing yourself. And ultimately you get tired and frustrated. And maybe you give up. But if you have resilience, if you learned how to adapt, maybe you think about what could be. What might I do? What's the question I haven't asked? And so, you can figure out how you both can win-win. So I have been a mediator for 20 years. I've run a mediation center in New York City, also with the courts and communities. And I did not come to Kenya because of the elections in 2007, but I moved here October 2nd, 2007. So I'll be celebrating 10 years in 2017 in 2 weeks. So this is where I was. This is a little bit of where I have been. You'll see the from here to there. It's a human development model. I like using tools. I like being creative. I might not be stick by the book. And I had a really great opportunity a little over a year ago to work with the Young African Leadership Initiative, which is based out of Kenyatta University, and also to mentor some of the Mandela Washington Fellows. And right now, Bilali Dicko might be watching online from Rock. Mm-hmm. And that would be really exciting because we're going to start working together. Online. So using, taking really, this is some tools from the Center for Creative Leadership, and they use a lot of research base. They've been known to have done really in-depth research at the very executive level, but they figured out how to take that and translate it to a very simple tool, a simple concept. So a really great idea, Leanna, to do that work on how to reach people who have significant barriers. Grisan's idea is really great. So that's, and then, where I was and where I want to be back is the water. All my life, in all the places I've lived, I've never lived more than a mile from the water until I moved here. So just a month ago, I was taking my family surfing for the first time. We did a family surf trip. That's my 5-year-old and my 8-year-old. One session, and we were on the water. So my kids love the water like me. And wherever I'm going next, somewhere, I need to be by the water. Even if it's in Norway and really freezing. And no. So that is water. And I, with thinking kind of about what you were saying in terms of walking and coaching, right? Walking in water, right? How do we use the natural environment to inspire us instead of make us frustrated, right? So we all had a pretty, what was the word, gong show this morning?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's frustrating, but then we still have to move on and function. So that's who I am. I'm a process person. I try to be creative. I love the water. I'm pretty active, though I could always be more active. And a lot of it goes back to my background, which is as a third culture kid. Some of you may know that term. It's someone who grew up in the country outside of the family's culture. So I grew up in Japan. Father was Irish, mother was American. And my parents were actually priests and a nun who met and married in Japan. So there's baggage. That's to start there. And now I'm living in Kenya, raising my cultural biracial children, 10 years, and I'm still learning. So if you don't mind, can we switch over to the taster session? Good. So the first thing, because it is all about process and asking for permission, how do we agree? Are we comfortable going with like 15 minutes over till 12:15? Okay, great. And just one more, some housekeeping, just to ask you to organize yourselves in a group of five. We're going to start with a little bit of a quiz. And there are papers in front of you. If you would not mind just not touching them and moving, because I will refer to them at different points. They've been strategically laid out. I happened to know the space before I came here. So I had to think through how to adapt what I'm about to present to the space that we're in. Into a concept called intercultural fluency. You didn't pick the word street, but another thing about me is since I've been a child, I've loved street food. Really loved street food.
Okay.
And I have memories of being in Japan as a child, dressed up to yukata, and walking around and taking anything I could find on the street. You're looking at me like I'm crazy. I am a bit crazy, which is why scat is the other word. But it's something that is important to me. And so we're going to take a skimmer, right? A tasting tour about this concept of intercultural fluency. It happens to be based on a product that was designed by the British Council, launched in Kenya earlier in the year, and is something I think you'll find interesting. It's all based on cultural identity and how culture affects your sense of identity.
For some reason, it's not mirroring. I've never had this happen so far.
So while we're doing it, could we just organize ourselves in groups of fives? We're going to start with a small cultural quiz.
What do I do when we're in a group of five? Turn it off.
And each group
maybe
should
just
have access
standing
to a
and the sample. It doesn't
green
stand in it.
Piece, oh, a green sheet. Anyone know PowerPoint? It's not. I've never had it done. I put in the presentation.
Okay.
So if you could be in a group, and each group have at least one.
Card?
Yeah.
I think it's that card now.
So are we ready to take a little tour? Okay, so our little cultural quiz. Please decide who is going to raise up the card, because that's going to how you tell me you know the answer in your group. And maybe introduce yourselves quickly too. Question is a true false question because we're going to ease on into it. True or false? Am I wearing Nairobi blue? True or false? Am I wearing Nairobi blue?
True.
What are the instructions?
Card up. Okay, yes.
True.
True. Anyone have a different answer? Paris?
False.
False. Okay, Paris
guessed
it.
I'll just use the...
Okay, so on your right, you will see Lupita Nyong'o, one of probably the most famous Kenyan actors to date, wearing what she called Nairobi blue. This was from the 2016 Oscar Awards. I am wearing Botswana blue.
Oh, sorry.
And it's Friday, and if I was in Botswana, I would be very appropriately dressed. But I'm not, I'm here. So Nairobi blue, Botswana blue. Right? You kind of, do we know our context? The next question is, who are you today if you're here on this compound? And it's not a visitor. Who are you today if you're here on this compound? Show me you know the answer by raising your card. Who are you today by being on this compound? There's a special event going on. Did anyone notice? Okay, do we have an answer? No? Okay, good. Ozone Heroes Day. So, yes. So tomorrow, September 16th, is World Ozone Day. And the Ozone Secretariat happens to be over here in the United Nations Environmental Program. The Montreal Protocol is celebrating 30 years. If you don't know what that is, please find out about it, because they have been entirely successful and renegotiated an amendment in Kigali last year that's going to help make our world better. So if you want to know what happens to your coolants in your refrigerators, these are the people to talk to. They're negotiating the contracts that talk about the disposal of these kind of items. And tomorrow, they have this huge celebration to celebrate the achievement, the full completion of the Montreal Protocol. And today, as you walk out, you will see superheroes, and you are one of them, because we're all heroes by being here today. Okay, so let's get a little bit, so that was something about Kenya, something about environment, so it's also about observation, right? Yep. Now I'm gonna test you and stretch you a little bit, because I mentioned that this is a product from the British Council, and you may have no idea what that is. You might even be curious, how does a TCK like me with no connection to England end up talking about the British Council? So, Leanne, can you show the next slide? Does anyone know where this is and when this was? When was the British Council founded? No answers. Okay. This is the original headquarters from Covent Garden, established in 1934. Next slide. How many countries does the British Council operate in? Anyone have any idea?
A lot.
So, a lot is relative, Hannah. If we were talking about SMEs, if you have 50 employees, you're a big employer in Kenya. So what's a lot?
200.
Okay, it's 100 worldwide. They have active programs in, and they've been in Kenya since 1975. From 75 years, sorry. So again, the taster we're about to do is all based on what they've known, what they've experienced for moving staff around, sometimes every 3 years, as Pankaj has alluded to already this morning. And they also work with professionals from Newcastle University. So please, let's enjoy. Let me press the next. Okay, so this is just a little bit about the program. I will not go into it. We have this flyers here, but I just want to ask the first question, which is now going into an actual question. What is culture? What is culture?
Hello.
So we are going to explore that further, but I want to just check in with you a little bit about what you're expecting from today. So in front of you, you should all see a card, right? Can you kindly, in your groups, discuss the question that's in front of you written on the card? And the four questions for the people who are on Facebook Live is the following. In what situations do you need the concept of intercultural fluency at work? We're really going to be talking about work today, not community. What are the aspects of intercultural skills you already possess? In what areas do you have strength? And where do you have challenges? So each group that's joining us here live in the face-to-face session has a question. I'm going to give you 3 minutes to discuss. Those of you who are online, if you could just answer the question in the, as you're in this, whatever it's called, what is it called? The chat?
Yeah.
Okay, the chat, and we'll try to respond. So, 3 minutes. Answer the question that's in front of you. So it's because of this. It's not.
I'm not sure why that stopped working.
So is there a way I can see that? Okay, I've got it.
No, I don't see. Hi, Anna. Hi, Carolina. On my screen, which is we're filming from, I don't see any comments. So, Kathy, are you able to log in and see if?
Yeah,
I don't know if I can see them on my screen or not. And I can see that there's two other people, but I can't see who they are. Hello, two other people. Anna and Carolina, your faces are popping up at the bottom, but I can't see. Feel free to say hi or ask a question. Kathy's just logging in, so we'll see if we can.
Shirley, Elizabeth, Jane, Ilya, and Isabel
are all online?
Yep.
Yay! Hey, Ilya! And you said Jane and?
Jane and. Jane Elizabeth and Shirley.
Okay. Hi Shirley, thank you so much for joining us. Can you see any questions on your screen?
No.
Can one of you just add a comment?
She said, Carolyn has already said.
Okay, great. Thank you for being patient with our learning process here as we do our first Facebook Live. I'll put the screen back on the questions there. Feel free to answer them. Put something into the chat box there.
Buzzes in the room. You're all talking, which means you all have something to share. So let's maybe hear what some of those are. And I've just asked Anne to claim if she could help us out, because she thinks about intercultural fluency at work all the time. And that might be the truth for all of us, even if we're not applying in a formal work setting. So for the people who had the first question, in what situations do you use intercultural fluency? Which group was that? Just maybe a brief summary.
I had the best answer. I think the majority of us would say, or all of us said, all the time.
Okay, so it's real, right?
Yeah,
it's like air.
It's just something you have to deal with every situation. Mm-hmm. I work with kids, they're TCKs, each of them has their own culture, mm-hmm. within their culture. Within our culture, you know, so it's ongoing.
And Sharon, can you share with us how many countries are at Roslyn this year? How many kids from?
Over 50, but the 64 kids I work with, 22 different nationalities.
Mm-hmm. And that's just nationality, not other groups, mm-hmm. and those cultural influences.
Yes, that's just nationalities.
Great, thank you. What about, what aspects of the skills do we feel we already have?
That was us.
Mm-hmm. Shruti?
We looked at flexibility, respecting the other culture,
being non-judgmental, being tolerant and patient, and also not imposing your cultural background onto the other party, so trying to kind of understand where the other person's coming from, and avoiding and being aware of stereotyping, because that's something that we can easily do, that okay, everybody's the same, that kind of thing. So just, that's what I came up with. Yes.
And what areas are still challenging for us?
The word that we came up with,
yes,
is assumptions that people can class us in a certain place and their assumptions. So those are the challenges we should face.
Great, thank you. And last but not least, what are your objectives, or what would you like to get out of today in our short taster session?
To understand and match and bring
the perspective. Okay, so how to understand more, how to merge it, how to recognize it. Great. Let me then thank you for sharing all that. Just checking in with those online. Carolina is saying that when you're interacting with anyone, you always have to deal with it. It helps enrich the conversation. And Anna's saying it can be challenging where viewpoints are dramatically opposite. Does that sound real to those of us here? So let's just look at, we need to go back. Our journey this morning until 12:15, we're going to again, go back to this concept of culture. How do we understand it? And I'll share with you a particular definition related to cultural identity. We're going to look at a particular tool called the Personal Cultural Global that will help us understand what are the different influences that come into play and how we might interact and maybe unpack, recognize where is someone coming from. Third, we're going to talk about behaviors that build rapport, this word rapprocher that the French talk about, how to connect with people. And just talking about observing and responding. And from our little quiz this morning, some of us observed, and some of us were still struggling because we were having a hard time getting in, right? So how does that relate to when you meet someone for the first time? And finally, what happens when things go wrong? Because they do. So that's our journey. So then again, this question, what is culture? In your groups of five, kindly identify 10 words that describe culture for you. In 2 minutes.
Feel free to participate online, Carolina, Anna, Ilya. What are 10 words that describe culture for you? Shirley? They come in and out. There's 4 now. Yeah, food and design and history.
All of them, you see, were
Description than a definition, isn't it? So we're really talking about how we describe culture and understand it, and we're going to posit it in the workplace. Now this must be the first time that a Facebook Live session has gone completely quiet. I don't want to make any assumptions.
advocate and move forward?
Yes.
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 Okay. So just a reminder, that culture is fluid, it is dynamic, it's interactive. I can be the same, I can show up to different people in this room differently and see myself differently. So we want to look, think of that cultural identity as how do I better understand myself, what those influences are on me in different points in time, how complex it is, and then how do I work through that for myself and for others within my workspace. So to help us do that, we're going to introduce the first two. So tell me about what you see. Okay, so tell me about the apple on the right.
On your right or our right? The whole apple, okay.
The whole apple.
It's green.
Yeah,
it's
what else?
It's shiny. It's
shiny.
Has no stalk.
Has no stalk.
It can last forever.
It's covered in something.
Tastes sweet and sour.
Has sweet and sour, okay. Is that, those descriptions, is that all an apple is?
No.
No, there's more to the apple, right?
Mm-hmm.
But what do you need to do to understand it? What else is there?
Bite into it.
So to bite into it and cut it in half. So on the right side, for you, you'll see an apple cut in half. Tell me a little bit about the apple cut in half. How many parts or components does it have? Maybe starting from the inside going out.
Seeds.
Yeah. Okay. What else?
Core.
Flesh.
Skin.
The skin. So the personal cultural global tool talks about these components as being the seeds being who you are, right? Your needs and your personal preferences are kind of combined together. Then moving outward to the flesh, which are five cultural influences that affect you, and then going towards the skin. So I want to just share with you the five, I'm going to leave it here as the five cultural influences, but the five cultural influences that have been identified as most important are those that relate to heritage, right? How does your family, how you grew up, right? Your family culture influence how you see yourself, how you understand yourself. It could be nation. So heritage, right? Family size. Family beliefs, big culture, small culture, regionalization. Another could be age. How does age influence your sense of identity? Then gender, with all its nuances. How does gender influence your sense of identity? And these are pretty standard, I think, when we talk about culture, aren't they? We identify those pretty quickly. But we also feel that in this particular model that your training, your education, your profession affects your sense of identity. Right? Many of us here are learning and development professionals. Several of us are psychotherapists, right? We bring that with us. If we sat down with a researcher or an engineer, we'd look at the same thing very differently. Right? Our sense of identity would be different. What we talk about, how we see the world. The same is with the organizational culture. And I think you got a bit of a taste of our host this morning, right? How easy or difficult is it to enter this compound? What's their sense of identity of who belongs and who does not? Right? That was very strongly experienced this morning. Yes, Anita?
I found it laughable that while I was getting my badge, they had a sign on the wall that said, United Nations welcome you, something about you all belong.
So you were made
citizens,
to
of the world, right?
Yeah.
And yet can't enter.
But that's part of the organizational culture. Security is hugely important, and membership, and it influences how we see the world. So think a little bit more about those five pieces of the of cultural influences: age, gender, your education, training, profession, organizational culture, and heritage. That even if we just focus on those five alone, It's a very nuanced, complex interaction with people we don't know, isn't it? And that's without adding the global, which is really thin if you think about the apple. But the part that's might be interesting is history. What's the history that's behind us? The history we understand. What history do we know? I mentioned I spent 3.5 weeks in Indonesia. And I learned a lot about Dutch history that I didn't know. Yet I grew up in Japan. I was first in Indonesia 35 years ago. I came with a very different sense as an adult, asking different questions. Economics, whose economy are we tied to? In some learning development spaces here in Kenya, they actually ask you that question. Are you based on the local economy or the international economy? And they charge different rates. Languages. Kenya is very oriented towards Anglophone, even if we speak Kiswahili or local languages or Sheng. It is very much an Anglophone environment and sense of identity. Religion. How does global religion influence and interplay with how you are? Some of the things that are going on in the globe, how we interact with them or understand them, might have to do with our religious backgrounds and our religious affiliations. Globalization. What do we know? How do we know it? Right? I'm still shocked when I see pictures of Tupac Shakur in places I have never expected. Years after his death, it's all about the power of music and how it goes around. So these are other influences that affect us. But we want to focus mostly on what we consider the cultural influences, the groups that influence us, age, heritage, organizational culture, training, profession, education, and gender. So think about your introductions this morning. Would you introduce yourself differently if you had known this framework in advance? What are some of the themes from the morning's introductions?
Family.
Right. So that's about interaction, groups, memberships, right? What else?
Profession.
Profession. Several of you talked about having a profession that you couldn't pursue here. Mm-hmm. It's about legalities, right? Location, membership. What else?
Age.
Age. Mm-hmm. How long you've been here, how old you are, but also who you're working with and interacting with. Differences? Anything else that came up this morning? Was it a theme?
Organizations,
right? So we have different types of organizations in the room.
Identity, so Kenyan or
being. So national identities.
Mm-hmm.
And professions. Anything else that came up? No. Yes, Jessica.
The sense of openness, there's quite a few people wanting to learn
more. So one of the things about intercultural communication, intercultural understanding, and just fluency is being open to learning and thinking about it differently. The more you think about it, the more you can evolve and change, because we do believe culture is dynamic. It's fluid. It's all about the interaction of who we're with. So if we come with that openness, Jessica, what do you think is the impact on other people? Introductions have been different, and would we have to adapt or feel the need to adapt or feel different? It's an interesting question, isn't it? Would I have introduced myself differently if you were mostly men?
Yes.
Would I have chosen different pictures? Maybe. So, can we get them? So just some things to remember about the concept of these layers, right, and the cultural factors of cultural identity is that it's a mix of factors that usually present themselves in a cultural situation. It's not just one. We often make it binary, but it is absolutely not binary. It's like those servers that go like this around and around, not singularly, but at the same time. It's like the solar system models that used to be there, right? They go around like this in different speeds in different ways. And some influences will be cultural, but not all. Sometimes we blame culture incorrectly. It might be something about globalization as opposed to culture, and being aware of that. That this particular tool might help you unpack at work, if a team, what are the influences that are at play here? What are the ones that we own personally with ourselves? But also, what are the external ones that we haven't really paid attention to? How are they influencing our sense of who we are and how we operate? And again, not rushing to blame all the problems on culture. It's much more complex than that, and you really do need to unpack it a bit. Part of it might be culture, but it's not all culture. There's personal preferences, there's needs that people have, and there are external factors. So I'll just give a quick example before we move on to the next piece. How many of you are aware of the fact that there's a lot of people in Kenya who work on commissions? Right? Commissions. You're in telecoms, anything sales based, you work on commissions. Is now a really hard time to be a commission-based employee?
Yes.
Why? Because the perception is the economy is not doing very well. So when you think about those people, they have real needs. They still have to pay their bills. It has nothing to do, but they're being affected by something external. Wouldn't it be a great time for them to be, those employers to be doing more about the culture of the team? I think it's a great time for training, personally, and team building. But everyone's going in from a deficit-based orientation, right? What if we could say, and more? Just a thought. And more. As opposed to not. But also thinking about those interactions. And what happens when needs are not met? Can people be their best self? Very hard, very hard. But they're being affected by the global level of culture and cultural identity, not so much that they happen to be part of an organization that operates in a particular way that cannot change its remuneration structure simply because of this unexpected downturn in the environment in the country. So people, it really does affect people's identity. So let's move on then to behaviors that support and build rapport, observing and responding. So next to you is someone you may or may not know. Ideally, pair up with someone who you don't know very well. Can you do that? Just turn your seats to face them. Further than you maybe have already this morning. Tell them a little bit about yourself.
Yeah.
levels up and continue talking. Raise your volume 2 levels up and continue talking. To a close. Curious to find out what that was like. Who's curious to find out what it was like to talk to someone in greater depth but in different ways? Can you press that? So here are 4 different ways to build rapport: internal self-talk, vocal delivery, what is being said, and also body language. So reflect back on the last 4 minutes. Which one of those 4 behaviors that I had you do was easiest? Which was hardest? And anything else that came to mind? And just think for 30 seconds about that. Thank you.
So I gave you the big picture of thoughts, right, on these four behaviors. As you're thinking, let me just kind of help you identify what each one of those are. So the first is very much internal. What is it that you say or think as soon as you encounter someone? Right? I've never met Charles before, but what am I saying and thinking, even subconsciously? What am I reacting to? Next is body language. Am I open or am I closed? Then there's what I say. Do I ask you, who are you, what's your job? Right? Or something along those lines. And then how I say it. Do I talk softly? Or do I talk very loudly and boisterously? So four different generic areas of behavior. So in our small encounter here, what was easiest for you in terms of meeting someone new or encountering something new? Which of these four behaviors?
I think for me, body language.
Why?
Because it was just two, it was intimate, and just there wasn't others, so and we're sort of sitting similar. So I think that was easy even to mirror.
Okay, mirroring, right, or
dissonance,
right, good.
Yeah.
Someone else?
Asking questions.
Tell me more, Faith.
Well, I think it comes as part of my job. I ask questions all day long, so it's very easy to ask something, how do you feel about it, and how do you see it, and why did you go in this direction? So that's much easier than when somebody asks me the questions.
Okay. Add on
to that, actually, because I've assigned
the
therapist, so my immediate thing was I wanted to ask Faye the questions, but she got in there first and said, okay, you go. Oh my gosh, what do I say? And then it was almost like layers.
Mm-hmm.
How much do you then say about yourself?
So those are great examples of how our professional training and identity come and affect how we engage with other people. What are some of the harder ones? Yeah, Jessica?
I like that you said
shout. Did I use the word shout?
Raise your voice like this.
So I demonstrated it and I said two volumes up. Interesting, you heard shout.
Interpreted.
So, but that's what triggers, right?
Yeah.
That's triggers. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Okay.
The uncomfortable thing about speaking louder than what you consider normal is then, okay, now I need to be careful what questions I ask because everybody else is going to be.
We're in a safe space. Mm-hmm. Even though we're on Facebook Live.
Yes.
I felt like the beginning was the hardest.
Tell me more.
Like knowing what she might want to be interested in.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when we started the conversation, but as our conversation got going, then it got very relaxed and easy.
Mm-hmm.
And I think we built an easy rapport quickly. But it's the beginning, it's that first little bit with somebody.
Mm-hmm.
I think the whispering so was a little bit uncomfortable to me. It's almost like you're doing something that you're not supposed to be doing.
Would your gender have anything to do with that?
Probably.
Or am I transferring? So again, right? Different influences. We may or may not notice them. We're here in an invited space. But what would it be like to be aware of all four of these in a new space? Imagine you're going somewhere tomorrow. So we're going to explore that a little bit in a small activity around these four behaviors. If you could, Mary, pass around. So in front of you, you should all have one slip that's laminated. We're going to pass around and make sure we all have two.
Can you give me a couple to film?
Yeah. We need two. Not in order. Please make sure you have two.
Do you need more?
This is an individual activity. So in front of each chair, there were at least one put out, and Janelle, there's another pack coming around. You should have two.
To those of you online, I'll turn those over when she says you'll have your own.
Does everyone have two?
No.
Please have two. Each person should have two.
I don't know.
So those of you who are at home with us, you'll see the PowerPoint that says internal self-talk, body language, how it's said, what is said. When Leanne turns over the examples, I want you to think, which tick is this referring to? Which behavior? Okay, good. So you should can turn over your two tips or two thoughts. And the task here is individually to look, to try to identify which of the four behaviors does this refer to. Is it vocal delivery, which is here in the front of the room? Is it internal, which is on the flip chart in the back of the room? Is it what is said, which is all the way back against the wall? Or is it body language, which is right over here behind Jen? And if you could get up and put your card in, against the appropriate label. Because of the space, if you just put it on the chair in front, that suffices. Let's see if we can identify which of the statement goes with which of the four behaviors. Kindly begin.
Can you just point out again?
Right, so in the front of the room is vocal delivery.
Yeah.
In the flip chart in the back of the room is internal self-talk. What is said is there against the wall, and body language is in front of the interpreter's booth.
I didn't see the session.
It's easier to hit this. You can just copy this. Let them see that. And ask them which go with which.
So here's some additional ones to categorize. For those of you online, so glad you're with us. We appreciate your time. So I observe how comfortable people are with interruptions and hesitate before interrupting at first. Does anyone want to put a comment in? Is that internal self-talk, body language, how it's said, or what is said? Feel free to reflect on that. What about I reflect on what's not being said and why? Is that internal self-talk, body language, how it's said, or what is said? Or I observe how much eye contact people are comfortable with and react appropriately. Or I decide how much time I need to spend on small talk and relationship building before moving into the main point of the discussion.
So I'm noticing that very few are against the wall, against tower. What are said?
They're on the chair.
Ah.
They're
five. Okay, that's about right. Okay, great. So how was that activity? Claire? What? Wasn't very challenging? Wasn't very interactive? I'm putting the labels. Okay. Okay. So what do you think was the thought behind it? Anyone else? How was the activity?
I'm still not real clear of the difference between interior and what is said.
Okay.
So trying to place it was difficult.
Mm-hmm. Do you remember which card you had?
The use of humor.
Okay.
With somebody I don't know.
So where did you end up putting it?
I put it in what is said.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't know, like I just, after talking to people, I felt maybe it should be an interior.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I have a similar one. What was said or internal, and I ended up putting it at internal. But now looking at those numbers.
Well, the numbers are only helpful if you know which card you have.
Yeah.
So maybe I can just kind of help you at a high level, because this is about a taster and time. And there's one more thing that we wanted to do in the time we have. But let me just open up to the group, right? So we could discuss these further. That is an option. Or, and that would mean
There's a particular way we could do it, or we can talk about what happens when things go wrong. And I think I'd like to leave it to the group in the 15 minutes we have left to decide which is most useful for you, given what objectives you identified when we first started this morning. Would you like to continue with this particular conversation and dig into it more, or would you like to move on to talk to, about what happens when things go wrong? Okay, so let's see, deeper dive into this ideas, these four behaviors. Any hands? Anyone online? Okay, I'm not seeing anyone. How about people want to move on to what happens when things go wrong? Okay, so majority rules, there's no court decision. Okay, great. So thank you for that. So if we move on then, just let me finish with some key messages, right? Next one, Susanna. So that in, generally we face situations that are unpredictable and you'll feel more comfortable and competent in some situations than others, right? And it's a lot about matching, but also even unknown pieces of identity. Observe closely and avoid giving wrong messages. So that also means you have a lot of self-awareness. And don't take quick offense. When you are discomfort, think about it, try to identify what is it about this that's making me uncomfortable, and don't be quick to react. So as we acknowledge, sometimes things do go wrong. So can you think in your mind of a situation where something, you tried hard, you had good intentions, but where things did not go the way you anticipated? Just in your mind's eye, if you think about that. Everyone has an idea? Okay. And when things do go wrong, do you have a preferred tip or strategy? Yes? So what I'd like you to do is with your partner again, think, share a little bit about what went wrong and what was the strategy that you employed and whether it was it useful or not. If you could take a minute each, that would be helpful. Very high level.
Answers for the particular card. So look and see if you remember your card and the number, which it goes for.
So the first two that you folks had was number 24 and number 26, and we also talked about 8, 9, I think, and 10. So let's see where 24, 26, and 8, 9, and 10 are.
What the situation was and what you did, I want to share with you seven techniques that often work when things go wrong. And in your pairs again, kind of identify one of these techniques you could have used and what might have happened.
which do you think you might have used? And give you, you know, maybe help each other. So Jane, your situation was X, so you and Marion decided of these, which could have been helpful to use, and what might have happened if you had done it? Okay? So pick one and apply it to your situation. And you have 2 minutes. And talked about the technique you used, and then thought of one of these techniques. How did you choose the technique? What helped you decide this is the right technique versus this one I shouldn't try to use? What criteria did you use? Trudy.
Yeah, it's more. I was looking at those words. Sorry. Apologizing. I think that always works, especially in Kenya.
Why?
Because I think it's just, again, it's the culture. I think temperature. But you know, we were just saying that if it's cold, you say I'm really cold, and the opposite person will say, oh, I'm really sorry, but it's not their fault. But you know, so it's just the culture, I think, as well.
It's an expectation.
It's an expectation as well.
It's a way of communicating.
Absolutely, yeah.
Okay.
Humor, I think I've used it quite a bit. Sometimes it works. It can be a risky one. It depends on how the other party might take it. So yeah, I think apologizing was a big one for me.
Thanks. How about somebody else? What criteria did you use to choose a particular technique to try or think about?
Number three.
Mm-hmm.
Acknowledging different perspectives without judging.
Mm-hmm.
So then that way the person you're with feels that they are heard. That you're not just jumping in there and trying to say all your piece, but hearing them, understanding them, and then trying to give them a different perspective.
Someone else? Yes?
Pausing the conversation.
Sometimes some conversations I've had are really, you know, they're going downhill at super high speed. And I find that I can actually see myself doing this. I always say, wait, pause. How did we get here? You know, or what's going on? And just the pause gets somehow relieves the emotions, takes away the
Tension.
Apologizing, yeah, maybe because
apologizing
maybe because I felt that it works better or well works better in that culture rather than in the culture.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Hannah?
No, it was actually the same. It was the acknowledging the differences. I mean, that being Danish and thereby quite direct, that would be a good way to resolve for me, but knowing also that I'm not always there because it doesn't resonate to the people or the person I'm speaking to or the situation I'm in. So I'm very aware of how direct can I be in each situation.
Mm. So there's some considerations, right?
Mm-hmm.
What's the relationship between me and the other person? Whether am I trying to influence them, are they trying to influence me? Might affect which technique I use. Whether I have an expectation of power, high power, low power, if you're familiar with that concept, power distance. And communication, whether it's direct or indirect. Some of them may be more useful than others, and some may not be appropriate. It might actually make situations worse. So what can we do? So the first is just be kind to ourselves, right? If we are trying, we have to give ourselves some opportunities, some kindness, because sometimes it's difficult to work across cultures or to encounter or work with different cultural identities and it's not working. We might like each other, but we're not moving along. But I've seen teams like that, right? Or we don't really understand how to work with each other, and we're not really progressing. So be kind to yourself. It can take time, sometimes up to 6 months, to get used to a new way of working. So even when you have a new team member join, the dynamics in the team change. Even if you've had ways of working, team charters, you still have to cannot assume that what was will continue to be. It's organic and it's always evolving. The second would be choose a technique that you're using when things go wrong very carefully. Think about what you know, think about yourself, think about these seven different techniques and what would be most useful in either just slowing it down so we can look and say what might be happening here, or also what you're comfortable with and what you can do authentically. Because being authentic is also very important. And last but not least, it's important to take time out to reflect on how am I doing? How am I showing up? What could I be doing more of? Or is there some self thing that I need to do for myself so I can show up better, so I can be better able to establish rapport? So that also inner work, if you want to use that word. What vibes am I giving off? So we kind of kind to yourself, choose the technique carefully, and then take time to reflect from time to time. I'm sure some of you have heard this, but it takes, you know, the science has said it takes 21 days to establish a new habit. So if you haven't been doing it, something, you start doing it tomorrow and you expect to get kudos, like woo-woo, from teammates, right, from at home or with the person at the dukkha down the street, don't expect it, right? It needs to be consistent, authentic, and with empathy, making that good rapport, and that will make a huge difference. So because of time, we're going to kind of just roll into the final bits, if that's okay. I'm just going to and we'll just check it online if there's any questions. Nope, okay. Can you just move the next? So this morning we've just kind of really, really skimmed the surface. I would say it's like skimming the fat off beef broth, if I can use that example, the complexity of culture and how cultural influences can affect how you interact with other people and how you can be effective in a global multicultural workplace. We also looked at four different behaviors that can help start putting you on a good path to engaging with others and also identifying where things might not be going as well as they can. And we thought about, we didn't really get into it, but the last piece was some tips on when things go wrong, what can you do? Seven pretty easy ones if you can remember them. So, press in. So now what, right? In terms of keeping in touch, what do we do with this? The first is there's some feedback feedback form I'd like to hand out, and also to get feedback. What was useful? What was important to you? Think about sharing some of your thoughts with the British Council because they are curious. This is the first time they're doing something of this nature. Learn more about intercultural fluency. Think about how to expand your learning. You heard about one MOOC with Coursera. There's another one with Future Learn on how to succeed in the global workplace, which might be useful for some of you, particularly those of you, Spire could be interested. The lady working at Roslyn could be interested. You could be interested with the disabilities and how to succeed. And it's a really good course online. And then sharing your thoughts beyond. We have the Facebook Live, but what I'll do, and I think Leanne, maybe you and I can think about that, like just a few questions over the next few days. Just to kind of ask, like, what came up, what would be useful, what could we do more of? So thank you.
Okay, just a couple of final thoughts here. Okay, so for those of you who are new to the roundtable, on the agenda is the link to the Facebook group. It is a private group, so you just need to ask to join. And as soon as I see your request, I try to get to that as fast as possible. Please use it to ask questions, offer resources. It's really your group, so use it as you wish. It would be great if you wanted to put some highlights of today's workshop, some comments, some questions, some additional resources, that would be really lovely. And know that the recording for this session will appear in that Facebook group, so you can look at that if you like. And there's a bunch of other resources in there, so feel free to take a look at that. Would love to hear, especially from you folks online, how the Facebook Live went. Was it frustrating, annoying? Did we keep the cameras steady enough? Just let us know how it went. Any suggestions for next time? Community announcements. Is there anything going on in your communities that you want to share? Any events coming up? Anything?
Oh, I have a fundraiser.
Jen? Yeah.
So, hello everyone. In addition to my role at Spire, I'm also one of the co-founders of EdTech East Africa, and we run meetups and different learning opportunities around education technology in Nairobi and Kampala. Coming up next week, the 27th, Wednesday the 27th, is our next session in Nairobi. The session is actually going to be around the impacts of the next elections on education and what EdTech can do to support. So maybe of interest for those of you that work with schools or have children, especially those facing ACSE exams coming up. So I'll happily share some information around that for this community. You're very welcome. See you there.
Yeah, I have that. It's a bit off the topic, but I'm sure it's everybody is much concerned also about our environment here in Kenya and well-being when it comes to human or animal well-being. And I'm helping out an organization called TNR, Trap Nature and Return. Mm-hmm. They are working heavily on eradicating rabies in Kenya, which is a big issue. Apparently, at least 2,000 people die every year in Kenya because of rabies. Mainly because being bitten by dogs who are not vaccinated against rabies. If you look into vaccinating a dog costs a couple of hundred shillings. Vaccinating a human being and treating after being exposed to rabies costs more than 10,000 shillings. And they are working on educating the people and also vaccinating dogs, as many as possible, and spay them so they don't reproduce themselves so quick as they do now. And there is a little fundraising event coming up in the Tribe Hotel in September. And I think I shared the information on the Facebook page, but whoever is interested is welcome to come along. Of course, there is a ticket you need to buy, but that goes completely to this nonprofit organization to help them to put together a mobile clinic so they can tour around Kenya, educate the kids, educate the grown-ups, and also they have vets who are working completely free of charge, who are helping to vaccinate as many dogs and cats and spay them on site as possible.
Great. I happen to know you can buy tickets for the fundraiser. You don't have to necessarily go to the event. So
yeah, you can go to the event. Or you can, from the volunteers, you can buy raffle tickets for 200 shillings per piece, and you can win some prizes. Of course, you don't have to go there in person. If you have some couple of hundred shillings to donate and just buy a ticket,
so you folks can see you for more information. Then?
Yes,
great.
Yes, I will just put a reminder. I will share a reminder in the
Perfect.
Group. So if you want to participate either way or just help out, come and see the animals, which they also try to rehome, and so on. So any way you can help out is welcome.
And any other announcements? Any other events?
Can I just say something? I would just like to repeat what Kathy said, and I'll just remind you. There's a MOOC on Future Learn, which is a British Council product on what Kathy just told you. It's of course free of cost, so free of charge. So please do. I would encourage you to go into that and join that. It's just a couple of hours a week, maybe 3 hours a week. We need to, just kind of read a bit and then give your inputs and comments and everything. It's a nice, and it becomes suddenly it starts with a huge 400,000 or 4,000 members or people, candidates who come into it, but it comes down to about 400 towards the end, but it's still quite interesting. So one is that, and second, I was just thinking, we can have such roundtables if you want, and if you please, we can organize them in British Council also in the future. So I would like to offer that also, if you have any ideas.
Okay,
if it's easier to get on site.
I'll make it simple.
And I'd recommend if you don't mind, maybe one of you can put a link to that course in the Facebook group.
Yes.
Awesome! Yay! Okay. I know some people came in at different times, so I'm just going to send the envelope around once more. If you haven't had a chance to donate and you meant to, my phone number's on there. Feel free to M-Pesa or slip some cash inside. I'll send that around. Lending Library is here. If you want to borrow anything before you go, just come see me. I'll stick you on the list. And next meeting, the networking session. Did you have a sense? Did you want to talk about how to serve particularly vulnerable populations or take part of that MOOC, or did you have another idea?
If I could just take what Jen was saying, if we did both, elections make certain people more vulnerable than others, so there might be something coming out of those EdTech meetings, and then the more traditional drought pastoralist, it could be a very interesting conversation about like, how do you deal with emergencies or education for vulnerable populations in general? One being an event, another being a circumstance, a location.
So you're suggesting that the networking session,
yeah,
we focus on how to serve vulnerable populations.
Yeah, and how do you plan for that?
Okay. Any other thoughts? Ideas?
Anita? I would love to hear the person who had
present?
Yeah, present.
Yeah. Okay.
As well. I mean, I think the topic wise would be fascinating to hear.
Yeah. That would be great. He's in a space where there's not much internet, and this is so cool. He hitches a ride with a local priest anytime the local priest is going to the next town, and he gathers people's cell phones, and they've queued up all these messages, and he brings all these cell phones and goes to the next town, and you hear the bing, 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 bing as all the messages go. So, because I initiated a conversation with him, but I haven't heard back, and I'm wondering if he's been to the town lately or not. So he has an amazing story himself. He's quite. I met him at a social innovation safari. So would that work for folks if I can get Brizan to talk a little bit online, and then we talk about how to serve vulnerable folks? Okay, great. And then the meeting after that is Anne Miltenberg. She was supposed to come today, so she's the person who does branding for social change organizations. She's wonderful. Her and her partner do all sorts of amazing things. So we've nailed her down for November 17th, and then in the new year, Anita and Ilya and hopefully another person are going to talk about trauma-informed training. So working with folks that have experienced trauma, and how does that affect our roles as learning and development people? So that's in February, I think, and then we'll have another networking session in January. At this point, just a couple very quick things. The mailing list. I'm switching over how I send out emails, and it's a bit painful, but the system's going to get easier. But know that if you're not sure that you're on my mailing list, please come see me, because I think one person got missed. So if the email was forwarded to you by someone else or something like that, you're just not sure and you want to be, please see me after the meeting and I'll double check and make sure that you're there. And I'd love to turn it over to Miriam at this point.
So I'd just like to take this opportunity on behalf of the group. I was just telling my group mates that I am in the middle of setting up a program in partnership with a US organization. So this topic was very relevant for me, and actually I've learned a lot of tips, because yesterday I was starting to get very worked up. So I've realized that I probably, those seven options, mm-hmm, there's lots of options and lots of ways in which I can probably make things a little bit better and easier for people. So thank you very much for this opportunity, and we hope to learn more from you in the future.
Thank you.
And thanks to you for coming, for your patience, for getting on the compound. Wish you a wonderful rest of your day. Let me know if you want any of the resources here to borrow. Yeah. There's some resources here to be handed out if you like. And much of this is copyrighted material, so we'll see what we can put up online. Know that we have a portal with the last 4.5+ years of meeting resources, so it'll be on there. Thanks to people who participated online, we appreciate your time. We'll click the end button, and then that will go into the Roundtable Facebook group. So thanks, everyone. Have a great rest of your day. Thanks for coming.
Just want to finish. You would like to give the feedback for